Hi friends, Mason Goodnight here, and today I'm going to give a brief summary of the five foundational tenets of the abortion abolitionism movement. And I pray that when we're done here, you'll want to join us as an abolitionist to glorify God, see souls saved, and see babies saved. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be here. We thank you for the opportunity to be able to make videos, to be able to share ideas, to be able to do that which glorifies you. And I pray that that's what this video does. It glorifies you. Let it be led by your spirit, Lord, not by my flesh. Let it be guided by your word, not by my reasoning. Let all this be done that it bring glory to you, Lord. That's what I ask. That's what I hope. Equip your saints. I ask it all in your name, Jesus. Amen. The five tenets of abortion abolitionism. Maybe you've heard of abolitionism before and you've wondered, why is abolitionism any different than the pro-life movement? What makes this movement different than pro-life? Well, these five tenets will help you to understand why it's completely different. So let's jump into them. The first tenet that you need to know is that abortion abolitionism is biblical. The foundational tenet of abortion abolitionism is that it's biblical. That's right. We get our reasoning from Scripture, not from statistics, not from worldly wisdom, not from politicians, not from pastors. We get our wisdom. We get our foundation for this out of Scripture, out of the Holy Bible. This is the only sure, solid, perfect foundation upon which you can build anything in this life. And therefore, this movement is founded on the Bible. Where else could it be founded? That's what we want to focus on. We want it to be the guide. We want it to direct this movement. And that's what it is. It is biblical at its core. It is trusting in God's word to be our guide. And if it goes against God's word, then we don't want to do it. So we're growing in the knowledge of God and how to walk it out. Number one, this movement is biblical. Number two, the movement is providential. Meaning the God who provided us the Bible is also the God that's going to provide victory over abortion. God's going to bring the victory. It's going to come when the church rises up and does what God says to do, regardless of what the world says will work. It's about relying on God's providence. Friends, it is so simple. A simple term you can take in is this. Obedience is victory. When we obey God, we've won. We can't lose when we do what God says. When we go to His Word and we do what He says, we have already won. God will provide the victory. He will do it in His time, and He will do it so that He gets the glory, so that all things point to Him to say, this happened because of God. Abortion will be abolished and criminalized because God did it. He will provide the victory, and He will do it when His people honor Him and follow the Bible, that foundational first tenet. So we're following the Bible, and we are relying on God's providence, not on the chariots and the horses and the strength and the wisdom and the money and the power of the men and women of this world. We're not relying on organizations. We're not relying on the strength of men's brains. We are relying on God's providential victory, and the victory is already ours when we obey. So let's obey God, be right with God, and then know that He will provide the victory over abortion in His time, in His way, through His people, to His glory. It is biblical. It is providential. And how is it going to go? It's got to be the third tenet, gospel-centered. Friends, the gospel is the power of God for salvation. It is the power of God for salvation. It is the key. It is what the Bible is ultimately all about. It is ultimately what the Christian life is supposed to be all about. And so we focus on the gospel being what drives abolitionism. Not scientific reasoning, though we will use scientific reasoning with people when the conversation leads that way. We don't focus on statistics, though we do see the statistics and we do know where they're at. We're not ignorant of them. But we focus on what does the gospel say? The gospel says that we are born in sin. We are lost. We are in need of salvation. We are lost and we are walking the wide road to destruction along many short paths may have got us there, but we're all without Christ walking a wide road to destruction. It's the easy path, Jesus said. And that's what abortion seems like. Abortion seems like the easy way out of a problem pregnancy. But it leads to all kinds of suffering, torment, sometimes even the death of the woman going to murder the baby. But it definitely ends in the murder and the death of the child. The wide road to destruction is where people are on, and the way to get them off that road is with the gospel. When we give to them the gospel, when we go to the clinics, when we go outside high schools, when we go to colleges, when we go to the public square, when we go to our state houses, when we go into our churches, when we go to our friends and our families and our neighbors and our politicians, when we go with the gospel as the driving central focus of this movement. Because the gospel is the power of God for salvation, not us. When we keep the gospel as the center, we will see God glorified, we will see souls saved, and we will see babies saved. It is happening. It will continue to happen for the glory of God, for the good of souls, and for babies' lives. That has to be our drive, focusing on the gospel, that Jesus Christ came and He lived that perfect life that we didn't. That though we have lied and stolen and hated and lusted and cheated and disobeyed our parents and done all kinds of wickedness, we have failed in meeting the commandment to love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and surely not to love our neighbors as ourselves. We have failed. And that's why the gospel is good news. Because though we have failed, Christ has not failed. Though we are imperfect, though we are sinners, Christ is perfectly righteous. He is the sinless, spotless Lamb of God who came to take away the sin of the world. And He did so. He died on that cross, and it is finished, He said. And therefore, we bring that finished message of redemption, the gospel, into conflict with the darkness that is abortion, that is this wicked system that it is in. And we call out to people to repent, come to Christ. And as they're humble, as they're broken, as they come to Christ in truth, they will turn from murdering their children. As politicians, as statesmen, as folks who are in government have their hearts changed by the Holy Spirit, they will be convicted by the need to stand on gospel truth. They will stand on what the Bible says, you shall not murder. And they won't make compromises with God's law. They won't make compromises against our very Declaration of Independence that says everybody's been given certain inalienable rights by their Creator, the first of which, of course, is life. You cannot pursue the liberty and the happiness without life. And when people understand the gospel, when people grasp hold of the gospel, they grasp hold of the joy of life. They grasp hold of the importance of life. They grasp hold of the imago Dei, knowing that they were created in God's image, and that those little image bearers, from the smallest, those who are being killed with abortifacient chemical birth control, those who are being killed through IVF, those who are being killed by Plan B pills, those who are being killed in abortion clinics, those who are being killed to the tune well over some 100 million, we're sure. Now, since 1973, when the gospel comes into conflict with it, when the gospel hits it dead center, the gospel is the cure. The gospel is the answer. We are driven by the gospel. We are going not just to see babies saved. We're going to make disciples of the nations. We're going to call out doctors, nurses, aborting mothers, supporting fathers of that, supporting grandmothers and grandfathers, supporting friends of that wickedness. We're calling them out and calling them to come to Christ and live, and we drive with the gospel. And that is why we are different. Another reason we're different than the pro-life movement. Number four, what follows? What makes sense? Number four, we're body-driven. We must be driven as the body of Christ to do these things. It can't be done by paid supporters. We can't pawn this off and pay for people to take part in this. We need to be part of it. Every one of us in some way, shape, or form. I'm not saying that every person has to be out front of a clinic. I'm not saying every person has to be engaging with politicians. I'm not saying every person has to be outside of schools. I'm not saying every person has to be involved in doing these different things. But you ought to be praying, and you ought to be seeking God in how you can be a part of bringing the abolition of abortion to bear on our nation's conscience, to bring this to the fore of their minds. You should be praying, you should be seeking of how you can get involved, because we as the body of Christ have all several gifts distributed as the Holy Spirit wills for us to work, for us to do, for us to be used for His glory in this world. What role are you supposed to play? You are supposed to play a role. This is the greatest Holocaust in our nation. There is no greater manifestation of sin than abortion of the unborn. Some 100+ million blood-soaked murders soaking the ground of our nation. If God heard the cry of the blood of Abel, how much does he hear the cry of the blood of over 100 million murdered babies without any voice, hardly at all, a very limited voice from the church in this nation? How is he not going to respond to that? We have all been part of being guilty in our apathy, in our failure to take part as we should, when we should, with the intensity which we should, and we have to live in a constant state of repentance, of turning further and further away from the world and more towards Christ, towards his goals, and towards what God says is righteous and true and just. Friends, join us. You who are in the body of Christ, join us in repentance. Embrace abolitionism, and let's drive on towards the glory of God for the purposes he set us to love him and to love our neighbors as ourselves. Let's do that, friends. Let's do it as the body of Christ, so that all our gifts together and all aspects of our life can bring about the abolition of abortion. Body driven. And this is where the toughest one, the fifth tenet, this is the one where we lose people the most. Because this is where it becomes clear without any shadow of a doubt that we are not at all part of the pro-life movement, okay? If the other four didn't already do it, if for some reason you think, well, those all seem to fit the pro-life movement, we can talk about that. But this fifth, this is where it hits a lot of people. Number five, immediate and uncompromising. Yes, immediate and uncompromising. Now, that means that that is what we call for. You see, think of the abortion holocaust in our country. Think of the abortion holocaust as a tree that's grown up big and strong and has been under the false color of law since Roe v. Wade. And it's a great, big, strong tree in our nation for almost half a century now. And what the pro-life movement does is, depending on where you fit in that pro-life movement, there are people in the pro-life movement, if it was a giant circle, they're in the part where they're like, well, I believe that we should protect babies once they can, you know, live outside the mother's womb, okay, or once they feel pain, per se, or once they have a heartbeat, and they get a little closer. So they attack different levels of that tree, whether it's that one that's way on the outside, like, well, they can survive outside the mother's womb. Well, that's hardly nothing. So they're out there maybe picking leaves off the abortion tree because they think that's wrong. Others are getting down and sawing off little branches. Some might be working on sawing a little bigger branches, but they're working on sawing down, they're working on trimming, and they're rejoicing over when they win, when they get a leaf pulled off, when they get a small branch chopped, and they saw it from the limb. Abolitionists are saying, no, the whole tree is evil. You shall not murder. And therefore, immediatism means we are driving at taking out the whole tree. What folks need to understand is that incrementalism, many, I'm not saying all, there are a great many pro-lifers who believe incrementalism is the way to bring about total abolitionism. What they don't understand and what they don't seem to recognize is that when you're working with people who don't want the tree to die, you are working with a fractured movement. You're fighting against each other, and you're never going to reach your goal because your movement as a whole doesn't have the same goal. The people just pulling leaves don't want the tree to die. The people just sawing some branches don't want the tree to die. They don't want it to die, and they don't want people held accountable for the sin of taking part in it, of growing it, of soaking it with blood. You can't win that way. Abolitionists say the owner of the orchard, who is God, said, go and chop that wicked tree down. So the abolitionist, with axe in hand, goes down to the trunk of the tree and starts hacking away to knock the whole tree down, to cut off the whole tree and all its wickedness. And yes, it is difficult. Yes, it is hard. And yes, it is sweaty work that seems to be slow and maybe impossible. But with God, all things are possible. We are seeking to cut it off at the base. The root of abortion, like all sin, is down there, is sin, rebellion against God. But we're going to hack that whole tree down by the grace of God, to the glory of God. We're not going to chop on limbs. That's what immediatism means. We are focusing on taking down the whole tree. It doesn't mean because we say abortion must be abolished that it will be, that it's going to be done and criminalized tomorrow. That's not what immediatism means. It doesn't mean that we're not taking apart the trees. Think of those trees as in every state in the union, there's 50 trees. And we are incrementally attacking at the base every single one of those 50 trees. And trees are going to fall at different times. But we're not going to prune them. We're not going to work with those in the pro-choice movement who are trying to nourish the tree, who are trying to actually fertilize, who are actually trying to make it live. We're not going to work with them. We're going to say, God says you shall not murder, and therefore we will not compromise. We will not compromise. This must be immediate, and it must be in line with the rest of these tenets. It's biblical. It's guided and directed and strengthened by God. It's centered on the gospel, and it's driven by the body of Christ. That's right. This is not an ecumenical movement. This is for Protestant, Bible-believing Christians. Yes, that's what I said. Now, I'm not saying that there won't be, by the grace of God, Catholics and non-believers who will say eventually, ultimately, yes, we need to abolish and criminalize abortion. But we need to lead the way. We need to stop compromising and saying, well, let's work with them. Let's go with the crowd to do evil, hoping that good may come. That's wickedness, friends. The Bible calls what the pro-life movement has been doing, and this is hard to hear, but what the pro-life movement has been doing with these incremental laws is called the sin of partiality. Look that up, friends. Look at that. It's all through the Bible, whether it's unjust measures or it's unjust treatment of people. The sin of partiality is saying that one person is more important than another. And every pro-life law that is put into being is a law that says, some human beings are worth more than others. When you write a law that says we will protect all babies after 20 weeks gestation, you are abandoning those 19 weeks and before to destruction. That is partiality. Writing those laws are what the Bible calls iniquitous decrees. Yes, friends, we're focusing on the Bible. We're not focusing on these things outside of Scripture. Again, we're not getting these from our human reasoning. I want to share with you some Scripture because you need to know that that is how we address this. We are not addressing this based on man's wisdom. Again, remember, this is driven by the body of Christ, who is founded on the Bible, who is looking for God's providential care, and we're driven by the gospel, folks. We are driven by the gospel to do this so that it comes down immediate and uncompromisingly. Listen to what God's word says. Remember, don't worry about my reasoning. Don't worry about the reasoning of your pro-life friends, pastors, leaders, anybody who's convinced you or you've got yourself convinced through your years of dedicated service in the pro-life movement. Don't let that sway you from seeing what God's word says. Look at these key verses. Very key. Isaiah 10, 1 and 2. Woe to those who decree iniquitous decrees, and the writers who keep writing oppression, to turn aside the needy from justice, and to rob the poor of my people of their right, that widows may be their spoil, and they may make the fatherless their prey. Isaiah 10, 1 and 2. Look at that, friends. Decreeing iniquitous decrees. That's what these pro-life laws we've all been guilty of supporting have brought about. Friends, we are guilty of this. I am guilty of this. I have had to repent of supporting these wicked, iniquitous decrees. We're part of it. Another verse, a couple verses. Let's look at Psalm 94, verses 20 and 21. Can wicked rulers be allied with you? Those who frame injustice by statute? They band together against the life of the righteous and condemn the innocent to death. Psalm 94, 20 and 21. Yes, friends, we here in America, we are guilty because we are a nation that was founded with the Declaration of Independence that says, like I've said before, that life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness are foundational. Without life, none of the others matter. We have a Constitution that says in the Fifth Amendment that no person shall face the loss of life or property without due process of law. And that is violated by abortion. And friends, we are a people with three branches of government. We are what they call not a democracy, but we are a representative republic. We are a nation that is of the people, by the people, and for the people. And therefore, we are guilty whenever a decree is put forth that is iniquitous when we have had any part in bringing it about. We can't say, well, we're doing the best that we could do. That's not what Scripture says to do. Scripture says repent. Scripture says do not do evil. Paul rebuked people who said of them, some are saying that we're doing evil, that good might come. He says their condemnation is just. Friends, we don't think of that as condemnable. We sadly, myself included for many years, looked at that as praiseworthy. Well, we're trying to do a little bit of evil. That we might get some good out of it. Yeah, we're abandoning certain children to death, but we're going to save some. Friends, the focus is not supposed to be primarily on saving children. That has never been God's focus. God's focus is to bring glory to His name in all the nations, in all the world. And when we compromise on this, we compromise on the glory of God. We can't do that. And because we're part of a nation of the people, by the people, for the people, when we vote for legislators, when we vote for statutes, when we vote for bills, when we sign our name to petitions that call for iniquitous treatment, call for partiality against fellow image bearers of God, we are guilty of committing iniquitous decrees. We are bringing about iniquitous decrees and iniquitous rulers. We find ourselves allied with those who frame injustice by statute. Friends, we don't want to be allied with wicked rulers. We don't want to have our name behind them. Now, friends, do not think this is saying that you can't vote. Don't try to take this and take the out, which is a foolish out that I hear many take, and say, well, if we can't vote for, you know, unrighteous candidates, well, we can't vote for anybody because nobody's perfect unless Jesus is running. That's foolishness, friends. That is foolishness to say that when you have a candidate on a prime issue, which should be a watershed issue, again, life, the foundation upon which all other things matter, that you have life. If you have a candidate that compromises on life, that's not holding them up to be Jesus to see that they're consistent on life. And there are candidates out there who are consistent on this. There are candidates out there who are abolitionists now. It's a growing movement. It is happening. They are not compromising. They are saying abortion is murder. You shall not murder. And our Constitution makes that clear. Our Declaration of Independence makes that clear. The Bible's our foundation. And we need to say you shall not murder. And if you murder, you face the same penalty for murdering anybody else. That is righteousness, and there are candidates willing to stand for that. That's biblical, that's Declaration of Independence sound, that's constitutionally sound. That's where we need to be. Yes, friends, Christians need to lead the way. Abolitionists are Protestant, born-again, Bible-believing Christians. They're not anything else. When we lead for the glory of God, if it be His will and in His timing, He will bring about the masses to stand behind in our system to vote righteously, because then they will be the compromisers and not us. We are supposed to lead. We are not supposed to follow the world in wickedness, hoping that some good may come out of it. Friends, join us in the movement of abolition for the glory of God, for the salvation of souls, and for the good of babies' lives. Remember these tenets, friends. And if you want to study them more in depth, again, get a hold of me. I'll get them to you. Remember them here. Number one, they are biblical. Providential. Gospel-centered. Body-driven. Immediate and uncompromising. The five tenets of human abortion abolitionism. We must stand firm on what God says we must stand firm on. Let us do this, friends. Let us do this today, prayerfully, humbly. Join us in repentance. Come out of the compromised pro-life movement and join us in the growing abolitionist movement. for the glory of God above all else, for the salvation of souls, secondarily, and for babies' lives, thirdly, and all of it will flow in that order. Join us in the growing abolitionism movement. God bless you if you do.